عبدتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها، جزاك الله خيرا، وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. وبعد، now inshallah we will continue our discussion regarding the way of the Sahaba. And as I promised earlier, probably this morning or last night, that inshallah the first part of this evening, the first part, we will be dealing with definitions and setting or laying down some foundations for the understanding of the way of the Sahaba. And that will involve, of course, some practical examples from the actions of the Sahaba and their statements, radiallahu anhum. So the talk is expected, inshallah, to be lively and not boring. But even more interesting, inshallah, towards the end or in the later part, we will be going over the seerah or the biography or some of part of the biography of one of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as we did in the case of Umar radiallahu an, and try to derive some morals from that discussion. First of all, we want to define the way of the Sahaba or the methodology of the Sahaba. The way of the Sahaba, when we say, or the Sunnah of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. And we have spoken about it a few times so far. So inshallah, a lot of what we say will be a repetition, just bringing things together or tying the strings together. First thing, when we say the Sunnah of the Sahaba, we should realize and understand that their Sunnah is only an extension of the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. So it's not an independent thing. It's not something that is contrary or contradictory to the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Rather, it is an extension and an explanation of the way of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. So sometimes it gives explanation of matters that were stated in a general way by the Prophet ﷺ. So the action of the Sahaba explains this general understanding. And as an example, in this regard, the Prophet ﷺ said, "A'fu al-liha," which means, spare your beards, do not cut them. Now, according to this general text, it means that you have to leave your beard and let it grow as long as it grows, even if it reaches your navel or further down to your knees or whatever it goes, wherever it goes. But the action of the Sahaba in this case tells us what is the Sunnah in regard to the beard. And we know there are reports, as our Shaykh Al-Albani rahimahullah brought together, and I think I referred to some of them in my book about the beard, that the Sahaba radiallahu anhum used to cut the beard if it grows over a fist length. So when they did not allow it to grow more than a fist length in length, more than a fist in length. So this action of the Sahaba restricts the Sunnah. The Sunnah is general. The hadith of the Prophet ﷺ is general, saying that you spare your beard and let it grow. Don't touch it. But the action of the Sahaba tells that this means their understanding from their living with the Prophet ﷺ and their knowing his actions and his intentions and so on, the way that he intended things to be, that the beard is not to grow more than a fist in length. So this sunnah of the Sahaba is an extension of the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ and an explanation for it. So it gives an explanation of the general terms of the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. And sometimes it restricts general terms. So the Prophet ﷺ says a general term, and the important rule that we should remember is that if this general statement of the Prophet ﷺ is restricted by the actions of the Sahaba, then we have to go by their action and not by the general statement of the Prophet ﷺ. And also the sunnah of the Sahaba is an extension of the Prophet's sunnah in regarding to new affairs that took place during the time of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, and that was not before. So that shows us how they made the derivation and they understood the sunnah so that they could continue to apply it after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam under new circumstances. So the sunnah of the Sahaba is therefore a branch of the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And it is an integral part of it, a part that completes the original sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And also we have to understand that the sunnah of the Sahaba, in terms of meanings and rulings, is part of the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Even though it was said by the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, or acted by the Sahaba after the Prophet ﷺ, yet we have to realize and understand that it is part of the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. The first text that we have which calls the way of the Sahaba as sunnah of the Sahaba is the text from the Prophet ﷺ himself that we went over yesterday, which is in the hadith of Al-Arbad bin Sariyah, where the Prophet ﷺ said, عليكم بسنتي وسنة الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين من بعدي عضوا عليها بالنواجذ وإياكم ومحدثات الأمور. Which means, adhere to my sunnah and the sunnah of the rightly guided successors after me. The sunnah or the way of the rightly guided successors after me. So the Prophet ﷺ called that a sunnah or a way to be followed. And similarly, there is a statement from Ali radiallahu anhu. And this hadith or this text from Ali, I have it recorded in the book of Closer Than a Garment, under the discussion of zina and the punishment for zina and so on. This statement is that he said radiallahu anhu, and that was during his khilafah when he was in charge, he said, جلد النبي أربعين. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم lashed 40 times, or 40 lashes for the people who commit zina, the non-married people, the single people who commit zina. وجلد أبو بكر أربعين. And Abu Bakr also lashed 40. وعمر 80. And Umar lashed 80. وَكُلٌ سُنَّةٌ. And all of that is a sunnah, which means an acceptable way. وَهَذَا أَحَبُّ إِلَيْهِ. And this is more dear to me. This is recorded in Sahih Muslim. No, I don't think, I withdraw my earlier statement that this is in my book about closer than a garment. This is, that was a different thing. The hadith of Ali over there is regarding stoning. But this is, he's talking about lashing the person who drinks alcohol. Because as for zina, the number is stated in the Quran. فَجِدُوهُمْ ثَمَانِينَ جَلْدًا. Lash them 80 times. So there is no room here for ijtihad, for opinions. But this is in regard to a situation where there is no text, which is beating the person who drinks alcohol. So he is saying that the Prophet ﷺ beat him 40 lashes. And similarly for Abu Bakr, but Umar doubled that to 80. And Ali radiallahu anhu selected to follow the way of Umar. Why he didn't follow the way of Abu Bakr or the Prophet ﷺ? It is probably because drinking became more widespread during his time. After the prohibition, the Sahaba stopped completely. But then, after people entering Islam and Islam spreading, they probably became, there were more people who were drinking, and there was need for more severe punishment to stop them from doing that. So he decided, or they decided for the 40, or they selected the 80 instead of the 40, wallahu alam. In the book Al-I'tisam Bis-Sunnah, in the book of Al-I'tisam Bis-Sunnah, which means the part called titled Al-I'tisam Bis-Sunnah of Sahih Al-Bukhari, there is a section, a large section, and they call it Kitab in the Sahih Al-Bukhari. By Kitab it means like a major section of the book. So in under Al-I'tisam Bis-Sunnah, the chapters of Al-I'tisam Bis-Sunnah or adhering to the Sunnah, as the author, which is Al-Bukhari rahimahullah, had a section or a chapter titled Babu al-Iqtida'i bi-Sunani Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the chapter of following the ways of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in that chapter he mentioned, or he reported the following report from Abu Wa'il. He said, Jalastu ila shaybata fi hadha al-masjid. I sat listening or studying, learning from Shaybah in this masjid, one of the Tabi'een called Shaybah. And he told him, Shaybah, جلس إلي عمر في مجلسك هذا. Umar sat next to me in the place where you are sitting, he told him. فقال هممت ألا أدع فيها صفراء ولا بيضاء إلا قسمتها بين المسلمين. He said, I am inclined to not leave any gold or silver. He said, yellow or white, which means gold or silver, but divided among the Muslims, which means I do not want to leave any money in the treasury. I am inclined to divide it among the Muslims. قُلْتُ مَا أَنْتَ بِفَاعِلٍ. So Shaybah told him, I don't think you want to do this. قَالَ لِمَا. So Umar said, why you say this? قلت لم يفعله صاحبك. He said, because your two companions did not do it. Which is, who are his two companions? The Prophet ﷺ and Abu Bakr, who preceded him. Both of them did not do this. They did not spread all, divide all the money of the Muslims among the Muslims, the money in the treasury. قال, and this is the important text of Umar, similar to the text that we heard from him before. Remember when his son, when he mentioned to him what Abu Bakr did and what Umar, what the Prophet ﷺ did, and he then selected what the Prophet ﷺ did. So this shows us how the Sahaba were so strictly adherent and followers of the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. So in this case, what the statement of Umar was, the very important statement that we should try to remember, he said, هما المرآن يقتدى بهما. هما المرآن يقتدى بهما. He said, those are the two individuals that are worthy of being followed. So if that's what they did, you are right. I'm supposed to follow their way. That's what Umar meant. هما المرآن يقتدى بهما. Al-Hafidh ibn Hajar said in his explanation of Al-Bukhari, Fath al-Bari, قال ابن بطال, أراد عمر قسمة المال في مصالح المسلمين. Umar was inclined to divide the wealth of the treasury, or the money of the treasury, in the benefits of the Muslims. And when Shaybah reminded him that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam And Abu Bakr after him did not do that. He did not select to differ from them. And he found that, or said, stated that following their way is an obligation. So there is some more discussion about this by Abu Ibn Hajar, that we will skip it inshallah. Okay, now this text tells us that the Al-Bukhari understands from the action of Umar radiallahu anh that where he followed the way of Abu Bakr with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that this is part of the i'tisam bis sunnah, adhering to the sunnah, as was the title that Al-Bukhari put in his book, and therefore it is part of following the Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So you see, the sunnah of Umar is just an extension of the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He does not come up with anything contradictory to it, something that conforms with it. So he follows his way, and if there is absolutely no text and no explanation, no statement as to how he did or acted, then there would be room for ijtihad, for deriving some rulings or regulations based on what they know from the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And also Shaybah rahimahullah, when he told Umar, I do not think you want to do it, it shows that Shaybah knew what is the attitude of Umar radiallahu anhu, and that he would not do anything different from what was done or preceded by Abu Bakr and by the Prophet ﷺ before that. And Umar radiallahu anhu confirmed this understanding of Shaybah. Another thing in regard to the sunnah of the Sahaba is this athar or report from one of the tabi'een, and his name is Salih bin Kaysan. He said, اجتمعت أنا والزهري ونحن نطلب العلم. And both of them are tabi'in, very important tabi'in. But al-Zuhri is much more famous and well known, and he is one of the important teachers of al-Bukhari rahimahullah. So many of the narrations in al-Bukhari go through the way of al-Zuhri to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he said, Salih bin Kaysan, اجتمعت أنا والزهري ونحن نطلب العلم. I was together with al-Zuhri when we were seeking the knowledge. فَقُلْنَا نَكْتُبُ السُّنَنْ, and we just both decided that we want to record the sunan, the sunnas. فَكَتَبْنَا مَا جَاءَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمْ, so we recorded what was reported from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. ثُمَّ قَالَ أَكْتُبُ مَا جَاءَ عَنِ الصَّحَابَةِ فَإِنَّهُ سُنَّةٌ. Then al-Zuhri said, I will also write, record what has been mentioned about the Sahaba, from the Sahaba, because this is also Sunnah. وَقُلْتُ أَنَا لَيْسَ بِسُنَّةٍ وَلَا نَكْتُبُهُ, but I said, no, it's not Sunnah, I will not write it. قال فَكَتَبَ الزُّهْرِي وَلَمْ أَكْتُبُهُ, so he says, الزُّهْرِي wrote, I did not write these things. فَأَنْجَحَ وَضَيَّعَتْ, so he succeeded and I lost in this. Superseded him, that Az-Zuhri did better than Salih, and Salih is committing to this or admitting to this some years after this was this happened. Okay, Imam Al-Kai, in his explanation of the creed of Ahl-Sunnah, he reported from Umar bin Abdul Aziz rahimahullah that he said, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz radiallahu anhu said, سَنَّ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ وَوُلَاتُ الْأُمُورِ بَعْدَهُ سُنَنَا, which means Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم and the people who were in charge after him started sunan, ways, sunnas, which means ways. And by the people in charge after him, he means the four companions, the four sahaba, Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and Ali. الأخذ بها تصديق لكتاب الله عز وجل. Adhering to those ways is a confirmation of the book, or a belief in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So to take, to follow these ways means you are following the book of Allah and you believe in it. وَاسْتِكْمَالٌ لِطَاعَتِهِ And it's also a completion of the obedience to Allah. وَقُوَّةٌ عَلَى دِينِ اللَّهِ And it provides power in regard in the deen of Allah, which means in practicing and applying the deen of Allah. لَيْسَ لِأَحَدٍ تَغْيِيرُهَا وَلَا تَبْدِيلُهَا And no one is allowed to change or alter these ways that were started by the Prophet ﷺ and his companions. وَلَا النَّظَرُ فِي رَأْيِ مَنْ خَالَفَهَا Nor is anyone allowed to look into the opinion, which means see if the possibility of accepting the opinion of anyone who differed from that. فَمَنْ اِقْتَدَى بِمَا سَنُّ اهْتَدَى فَمَنْ اِقْتَدَى بِمَا سَنُّ اهْتَدَى This is also one of the important statements. Whoever follows what they have started, what they have devised as a way to follow, he is guided. Whoever followed their way is guided. وَمَنْ اِسْتَبْصَرَ بِهَا بَصَرَ Or بَصُر يَبْصُر Yeah, بَصُر And whoever views or uses them to see his way, then he is as seeing, which means he is not blind, he sees his way. وَمَنْ خَالَفَهَا وَاتَّبَعَ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ And whoever disagrees with them and follows a way other than the way of the believers, وَاللَّهُ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ مَا تَوَلَّاهُ وَأَصْلَاهُ جَهَنَّمَ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا Allah Azza wa Jalla will give him what he deserves and he will punish him in the hellfire and it is indeed the best of abodes. In this he is referring to the ayah that we will be mentioning very soon inshaAllah. Imam Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah in his book I'lam al-Muwaqqi'in an Rabb al-Alameen he mentioned under the title اتباع الحق في سنتهم that following the truth is in their sunnah, the sunnah of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. He said, he cited what was said by Jundub bin Abdullah radiallahu anhu, one of the Sahaba. He said, a group of the Khawarij came to him, came to Jundub bin Abdullah radiallahu anhu, and they said to him, فقالوا ندعوك إلى كتاب الله. فقال أنتم They came to him and they said, we invite you to follow the book of Allah. They are coming to Jundub bin Abdullah, one of the Sahaba, and they are saying, look, we want you to follow the book of Allah. You know, little kids coming to the big teacher and saying, we want you to follow the book of Allah. And unfortunately, we see this all the time. Like in our time, there are people who are very new in knowledge. And in the da'wah and in the manhaj. And they set themselves as judges over others who are much senior than them in knowledge and understanding. And they say, take from this and do not take from that. As I have explained in my set of tapes, Al-Wasatiyya, which was a set of tapes that I gave last month in Toledo. And I advise the brothers to listen to them because they include important warnings against such attitudes that we see unfortunately becoming widespread in our time among the ignorant people who just became Muslim like 6 months ago all of a sudden they say we are Salafis and the next thing they are doing is that they are making this person a Muqtada and this person doesn't know what he's talking about and so on and I think I mentioned this in the tapes there, but I'll mention it here again also for the benefit of those who will not hear the tapes, that somebody told me that some of those new young brothers that I gave them advice by email once, don't waste your time in these matters, but go and study the knowledge instead, because you are still very limited in your knowledge. So some of those went to a brother in Toronto who sells my books. And he told me, they came to me and they asked me, they said, you should put a disclaimer on the books that you sell that even though this book may contain some beneficent matters, but the author has some problems in his manhaj, or some problems in his aqidah, or some problems depending on who is the author. And they included my books, that you should put disclaimers on them. I said, MashaAllah, I would love to meet with these brothers and have them give me a test in manhaj and aqidah, or else I give them a test in manhaj and aqidah. Because, subhanAllah, you find people who are very, very young and ignorant, they set themselves as the judges on those who are above them, and this is of the attitude of the Khawarij. This is of the attitude of the Khawarij. I'm not saying that those brothers are Khawarij. I'm saying this is of the attitude of the Khawarij. As you see how they behave, those Khawarij, with one of the noble Sahaba, Jundub bin Abdullah, they came to him and they said, "We invite you to the Book of Allah." He said, "You?" They said, "Yes, we." He said, "You?" Again. He said, "Yes, we." So he said, يا أخبيث خلق الله في اتباعنا تختارون الضلالة. He said, "You, the most filthy of the creation of Allah, instead of following us, you select," which means the Sahaba, "you select misguidance. أم في غير سنتنا تلتمسون الهدى, or as are you seeking guidance in a sunnah other than our way?" Or as he said, فَاتِّبَاعِنَا تَخْتَارُونَ الضَّلَالَ, which means, "Do you see that following us is misguidance, and in following a way other than our way is guidance? أُخْرُجُوا عَنِّي, get out from here. Don't stay in my presence." So again here, one of the Sahaba is calling their way a sunnah. He says, "Fi sunnatina," which means in our way. Imam al-Shatibi rahimahullah, who wrote the book Al-Atisam, one of the most important books about adhering to the Sunnah, Al-Atisam bil-Sunnah, adhering to the Sunnah, and he wrote the book Al-Muwafaqat, which is one of the most important books in the usul of fiqh. Imam al-Shatibi, he is from Andalusia probably, or North Africa. رحمه الله. So he said, سنة الصحابة رضي الله عنهم سنة يعمل عليها ويرجع إليها, ومن الدليل على ذلك أمور. He said, the sunnah of the Sahaba رضي الله عنهم is a way that should be followed and referred to, and there are many proofs for this. And then he started telling what are the evidences for what he's saying. This sunnah of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum is preserved by Allah Azza wa Jalla, as He promised to preserve the deen as a whole, and this is part of the deen. إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. We have revealed the dhikr and we will preserve it. The dhikr means the Qur'an plus everything that is needed to explain and understand the Qur'an, which is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and its extension, which is the sunnah of his companions radiallahu anhum. And one of the indications in this regard, or the evidences, is Allah saying, وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى وَيَتَّبِعَ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّى وَنُصْلِهِ جَهَنَّمَ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. Whoever contends with the messenger, whoever displeases the messenger after guidance has been shown to him, and follows a way other than the way of the believers. The believers mean the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, because when the Quran was revealed, they were the believers. So it's referring to them before it refers to anyone else. So, and follows a way other than the way of the believers, سَبِيَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّى, we give him what he deserves, or what he chose, وَنُصْلِهِ جَهَنَّمُ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا, and punish him in the hellfire. وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا, indeed the worst of abodes. This is similar to the statement that you heard earlier from Umar ibn Abdul Aziz radiallahu anhu. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah indicated that this ayah makes it an obligation to follow the way of the believers, and makes it prohibited to follow a way other than their way. Because it's obvious. The ayah says if anybody follows, does that or follows, which means follows a way other than the way of the Prophet ﷺ or the way of the believers, then he will be punished by the fire. And this ayah calls the believers to follow the straight path and tells that the sunnah of the Sahaba of Rasulullah ﷺ is part of that straight path. And that means that this means that the sunnah of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum is preserved, because Allah Azza wa Jalla would not refer us to something that is not available. He would not say and follows a way other than the way of the believers, and then when we ask where is the way of the believers, the answer says it is lost, it is not recorded, we do not know what it is. It can't be. So Allah Azza wa Jalla is telling us to follow something that is available and existing. And this tells that the way of the believer, the way of the Sahaba, is preserved and is part of the overall preservation of the deen. And similarly, the wasiyah that you heard from the Prophet ﷺ when he told his companions to follow his way and the way of the rightly guided successors after me, then he would not command us, the ummah, to do this if this sunnah, the sunnah of the Sahaba, was not to be preserved. Also, in addition, there are some other proofs for this, such as the hadith that we mentioned yesterday, لَا تَزَالُ طَائِفَةٌ مِّنْ أُمَّةِ ظَاهِرِينَ عَلَى الْحَقِّ. There will always be a group of ummah who are given victory upon the truth. And this group this hadith in this form is in Al-Hakim, and it's verified to be authentic by Al-Albani. A similar narration of it, that's in Al-Bukhari and Muslim, لَا تَزَالُ طَائِفَةٌ مِّنْ أُمَّتِي قَائِمَةٌ بِأَمْرِ اللَّهِ. There will always be a group of my ummah establishing the commands of Allah. This is in Bukhari and Muslim. And this indicates if there is such a group, that means that there will always be a group that has access to the way of the full understanding of Islam, the book, the sunnah, and the sunnah of the Sahaba radiallahu anhu, to the end of time. In regard to adhering to the jama'ah, Al-Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah reported the hadith of Umar radiallahu anhu in regard to the importance of adhering to the jama'ah. And then he said, إِذَا كَانَتْ جَمَاعَتُهُمْ مُتَفَرِّقَةٌ فِي الْبُلْدَانِ فلا يقدر أحد أن يلزم جماعة أبدان قوم متفرقين وقد وجدت الأبدان تكون مجتمعة من المسلمين والكافرين والأتقياء والفجار، فلم يكن في لزوم الأبدان معنى لأنه لا يمكن، ولأن اجتماع الأبدان لا يصنع شيئا فلم يكن للزوم جماعتهم معنى إلا ما عليه جماعتهم من التحليل والتحريم والطاعة فيهما، ومن قال بما تقول به جماعة المسلمين فقد لزم جماعتهم. I don't think that this is the best proof to bring here, because even though it's obvious what he is implying, but it's not transparent. What he is referring to, the hadith of in which the Prophet ﷺ commanded to stay with the jama'ah. Like he said, عليكم بالجماعة, adhere to the jama'ah. And we explained yesterday what is the jama'ah, that the jama'ah of the Sahaba. So Al-Shafi'i here is saying, it cannot be that the Prophet ﷺ is telling us to adhere with the jama'ah when the jama'ah is spread all over the world. Because how can you be with people whose bodies are separated like that? So in other words, he's saying the jama'ah is the first jama'ah, the jama'ah of the Sahaba. So you have to follow the way of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Okay, what does the Sunnah of the Sahaba include? The Sunnah of the Sahaba includes two major things. The first thing, تفسير وبيان للكتاب, explanation of and clarification of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ولسنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, and the Sunnah of رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. So the Sunnah of the Sahaba includes the explanation of the texts of Islam, the Quran and the Sunnah. تفسيرا قوليا أو فعليا, either by sayings or by action. أو تأصيلا لمفهوم من مفاهيم الكتاب والسنة, or as to establish an understanding of the matters or the affairs of the book and the Sunnah. The second matter, الاجتهاد في الأمور المستجدة بعد زمن الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم. Performing اجتهاد, which means striving to reach the best judgment in regard to the matters that came up after the time of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. وتلبية الحاجات العلمية للأمة, and fulfilling the الحاجات, I think it is العملية not العلمية here, because otherwise it wouldn't make sense to me. And fulfilling the practical needs of the ummah, fulfilling. So they had to make ijtihad for the in regard to the practical matters that came up to resolve those matters after the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. وإيجاد الحلول المشكلة التي تطرد سبيلها, and finding solutions for the problems that come across them. They come across. There are some matters of usul, which means in regard to the usul of fiqh or the foundations of fiqh, that we do not need in this discussion to get into, such as I'll just give some brief overview of this. For example, what if the Sahaba, if we have reports, conflicting reports from the Sahaba, if we have conflicting reports, like one of the Sahaba says something and the other says something else, so they do not agree on a certain issue, whose opinion or whose side should we take? And can we say that each one of them or each side, his action or their action or their understanding is considered as being of the Sunnah that we are required to follow? And the answer is no, because Allah Azza wa Jal says, يا أيها الذين آمنوا أطيعوا الله وأطيعوا الرسول وأولي الأمر منكم فإن تنازعتم في شيء فردوه إلى الله والرسول إن كنتم تؤمنون بالله واليوم الآخر. Which means, all you who believe, obey Allah and obey the Messenger and those charged by, with authority among you. And that includes the ulama, the scholars, starting from the Sahaba down. فإن تنازعتم في شيء, but if you differ in regard to a certain matter, فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ, refer it to Allah and the Messenger, إِن كُنْتُمْ تُؤْمِنَ بِاللَّهِ وَمِنْ الْآخِرِ, if you believe in Allah and the last day. So if there is difference in opinion among the Sahaba, we have to refer the difference to Allah and the Messenger, which means we have to present the difference or to the book and the Sunnah, to the Quran and the Hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, and see if that can resolve the difference. If the difference cannot be resolved, which means that this difference in opinion does not have a proof for it, for either side of the difference, then you can say that this is of the acceptable type of difference, because there's no weighing evidence for either side. And an example could be cited, even though it's not a good example in this regard, is when the Prophet ﷺ told the Sahaba, do not pray Asr except fi Bani Qurayza. do not pray Asr until you get to the dwellings of Banu Qurayza, the Jews who betrayed the Prophet ﷺ, because he had covenant with them to protect him and cover his back while he was fighting with the Arab tribes who came and attacked him from the front. But what happened is that as soon as he was surrounded by those Arabs from the front, the Jews betrayed him from the back and tried to attack him, and they supported the Arabs who were the Arab tribes who were attacking from the front, the Mushrikeen. So when he defeated, when Allah Azza wa Jal defeated the disbelievers, as he says in Surah Al-Ahzab, the Prophet ﷺ immediately turned to the Bani Qurayza. So he did not give them any chance to regain their breath, as you say, or to have time to put together their forces and so on. But immediately he told the Sahaba, and without their expecting him to move so fast, he said, go straight. Even though the Sahaba were so tired and exhausted from their preparation and their waiting for the fight with the enemy in the Al-Khandaq, yet he did not give them time and said, turn around and go straight to Banu Qurayza. So as an emphasis to that, he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, let not any of you pray Asr but in Bani Qurayza, which means go straight and pray Asr over there. Now, in their travel to Banu Qurayza, the Sahaba could not make it in time to be able to pray Asr in Bani Qurayza, because of the distance and at the time the sun set before they could reach Banu Qurayza. So some of the Sahaba, their understanding was that the Prophet ﷺ meant that do not pray Asr except in Bani Qurayza, means that rush to Bani Qurayza. But he did not mean miss Asr prayer, but if you find that it's not possible to pray it in Bani Qurayza, so stop and pray it and then keep going. That was the understanding of some of them. Others among them took it literally that pray the Asr in Bani Qurayza means regardless, even if you miss the prayer, you still have to get to Bani Qurayza and then you pray there. And when they came, when they got there, the Prophet ﷺ did not blame either of the two sides. Now, when he did not blame either of the two sides, it doesn't mean that both sides were correct. It doesn't mean that both sides were correct. What it means is that both sides made ijtihad, tried to reach the truth, the best opinion, and because of this, both of them are rewardable. Both of them will get a reward. But it doesn't mean that both are right. It can't be that both are right. One of them was right and one of them was wrong. And Allahu A'lam, the more correct opinion of the ulama is that those who stopped and prayed are the ones who were more correct. Now, since it was still during the time of revelation, when the revelation was being sent down, then it could be, you can understand that the Sahaba thought maybe the time of Asr would be extended for us, or that in such situations it's permissible to miss Asr. But now after the revelation was completed, we know that no, Asr time ends by sunset and there is no way to extend it beyond. So they should have all stopped and prayed Asr along the way. And that the Prophet ﷺ, by his command, he meant that you, if you can make it to Bani Qurayza, do not pray Asr along the way, but get there and pray it, otherwise pray on the way. So this was, Allahu A'lam, the correct of the two opinions, but both of them are rewardable for what they did, and that's why the Prophet ﷺ did not blame them. And this agrees with Ajrun Wahid, which means the hakim, the person who has the ability to make a hukum, a ruling, if he makes ijtihad, strives to reach the truth, and he hits the truth, he gets a double reward, two rewards. And if he misses it, he gets one single reward. So in either case, he is rewardable. But we cannot say that in either case he is right, like some people say, that when he makes ijtihad, he's always right. Whatever he selects, no, this cannot be, because there is only one truth. In every matter, there is only one truth. There are matters which give more than one option, but in the rulings, in Islamic ruling, usually there is only one right, and the other options are wrong. So that's why I'm saying that would not be a good example about the about what we were saying, that if the Sahaba differ about certain matters and there's no weighing evidence, there's no clear evidence to weigh one side over the others, then you can select to follow either side. There could be, and I'm sure there are some situations like that, but as I said, this example is not the best example to follow because it is controversial and the scholars differ about it, and the more correct opinion, Allahu A'lam, is the one I said, that one of the two sides was right and the other was wrong. But there could be cases where there's absolutely no evidence from the Quran or the Sunnah to tell us which one was right and which one was wrong. In that case, the matter is open for one to choose whichever side to follow. So, other than this, if the Sahaba differ, except in this case, in this kind of situations, which would be very limited, other than that, if they differ, you follow the side which is with the Sunnah, which has more evidence on his side. The Sahaba will have more evidence on this side, on their side. And we know that the Sahaba differed on many, many issues. And among the best books that discuss this is the book by Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, رفع الملام عن الأئمة الأعلام. Which means raising the blame of the noble imams or the noble scholars. In that book he shows why the scholars sometimes differ, why they differ in opinion about various issues, starting from the Sahaba and down, why we have difference in opinion. And he shows the reason that could lead to a difference in opinion, and he shows that even the Sahaba differed, and even Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu sometimes made a wrong ijtihad based on some limited knowledge that he had in a certain area, and sometimes he was corrected and he accepted the correction, and other times he was never corrected, he did not know about it was not known until after him that what he did was wrong. And similarly for Umar, similarly for Uthman, similarly for all of the Sahabas. So not everything that they said was absolutely correct. But if they agree on a matter, then this matter is usually the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, or an extension of the Sunnah, and you have to go by it. If they differ, then I explain what you do. Now, if we have only like one or two of the Sahaba who take a certain position or a certain opinion, but we do not know if the other Sahaba agreed with them or not, what do we do in this case? In this case, following this one or two of the Sahaba, if what they say or what they decide is not in discord with the Hadith or with the Quran or with the Hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, following them is better than following anyone after them. And therefore following them is part of following the Sunnah of the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. Did you understand what I just said? That there could be three different situations. The first situation, let's make them more than three. I wish I had a blackboard. Usually I like to write on blackboard in these cases so that people will see what I mean, but you know, try to visualize it inshallah. There's the first case where the Sahaba agree on something. They have the same opinion. That's okay, I mean, it's not much inshallah. They agree on one issue. Now when they agree, it could be that they agree on something contrary to the Hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. And there are very rare cases like this. In this case, we would rather take the Hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, and we say that the Sahaba, whatever they agreed to, they were not aware of the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. And we cannot be certain that every single Sahabi in the whole world at their time agreed to what was reported to us from them. But in general, when the Sahaba agree on something, that means that this is the Sunnah. So it is part of the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. The second situation, they disagree. If they disagree, we go with the side who has more evidence with him from the Quran and the Sunnah. So the third case is that we have statements from a limited number of the Sahaba, one or two or three, and we do not have anything contradictory from the other Sahaba. Okay? So it's not like a consensus or the opinion of a large number of the Sahaba, it's just the opinion of one or two individuals among the Sahaba. In that case, if that opinion does not disagree with the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, then we have to take it, and this is part of the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And taking it is definitely better than taking the opinion of anyone who came after them. And we have to remember that the Sahaba are not liable to coming together or getting together on an opinion that is invalid or that is against the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And therefore, when they agree on a certain issue, then it would be of the matters that then that issue would be in agreement with the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As I pointed out a little bit ago, there could be cases where we have the opinion of a large number of the Sahaba, and this, but there is a Sunnah that differs from a Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In that case, it would be, or it could be, it's very possible that that Sunnah would not reach that those Sahaba from whom that opinion is reported, even though they are a large number. And there could be some others who followed the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. But you know, these are like limited cases, very little cases that arise among the specialized scholars of usul, and they do not, you know, they are not enough to form a trend or a separate issue, a separate category that we need to study and understand. So there's no need actually to confuse ourselves a lot by them. And therefore, you know, as a second summary of what I said, to make it even easier to remember, I say that the Sahaba either agree on something without we knowing of anyone among them who disagrees with that, so this is of the Sunnah and we have to follow it. The other case is that they could disagree about some issues. In that case, we follow the side that has more evidence with it. Okay,
I think I should stop because we have spent close to an hour on this now. And there is much more to say about in regard to the usul or the fundamental matters regarding the adherence to the Sunnah of the Sahaba radiallahu anhu, but I think we have covered enough of that already, and inshallah the rest of the time I will do what I promised of going over or the lighter side of this discussion, which is going over the story of one of the Sahaba رضي الله عنهم. Did I say Sulaim? Abu Talha? Okay, that's what we'll do then, inshallah. The story of Sulaim and Abu Talha رضي الله عنهم. Sulaim رضي الله عنها was the mother, or is the mother of Malik bin Anas رضي الله عنه. and you probably have heard the name of Malik many times, very frequently, very often. He is one of the Sahaba al-Mukthirin who have reported a lot of hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he's among the few who reported a lot of the hadith, like Abu Huraira, Ibn Umar, Aisha, Anas, Abdullah bin Amr. Where's? No, Tirmidhi is not a Sahabi. I'm saying of the Sahaba, Abdullah bin Umar, Ibn Abbas, Abdullah ibn Abbas, and so on. So those are the Sahaba who have reported a lot of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, more, much more than anyone else. There's like six or seven of them, and Anas is one of them. Anas served the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for 10 years, from the age of about when he was about 10 years old till he was about 20 years old. So from the time that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to Al-Madinah until the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away, almost during this whole period, Anas served the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the way that it started, I don't think it's mentioned here, is that Anas came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and she told him, "O Allah's Messenger, this is my son Anas. I would like him to serve you." And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam accepted her offer, which was a great thing to give to Anas. You know, this mother made her son the close student of the greatest man that you can ever be a student of, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, by having him serve him and watch him closely and learn things from him directly without any intermediacy. So Anas radiallahu anhu reports a lot of the private incidents or affairs of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as I explained in my series of talks about the shama'il, or the physical qualities of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that many of them, many of the narrations in that regard are said by Anas, because he was closely in relationship with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he observed his actions and his manners and his behavior firsthand, and so the reports are mostly from him. So Anas here is reporting this long hadith about his mother, Sulaim. And as I said, Sulaim was it was his mother, so she was married to his father, of course, before his father died. And his father was called, what was Anas' father's name? Malik. His name is Anas bin Malik. Anas, the son of Malik. So his father was called Malik. And his father died as a kafir. His mother, Sulaim, embraced Islam. And her husband refused to embrace Islam. And she told him he must become Muslim. But he left and ran away to the Romans, to Palestine or that general area of Sham. And he was, I think he was attacked by some robbers and died. He was killed. So he died as a kafir. He never embraced Islam. So Sulaim had her son Anas. And actually there's a brief mention of this here, even though there are some other reports which have more details of the death of Malik. Here Anas said, قَالَ مَالِكٌ أَبُوْ أَنَسْ لِمْرَأَتِهِ Sulaim, that Malik, his father, said to his wife Sulaim, إِنَّ هَذَا الرَّجُلْ أي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يحرم الخمر فانطلق حتى أتى الشام فهلك هنالك. So he said, this man wants to make khamr liquor prohibited. He didn't like that. So he left and ran away. until he got to Sham, and he died over there in Sham. When Malik died, or after Malik died, Abu Talha, one of the most wealthy people of Al-Madina, came to Umm Sulaym and asked for her hand in marriage. خطب أم سليم فكلمها في ذلك. He asked her to marry him. فقالت يا أبا طلحة ما مثلك يرد. She said, oh Abu Talha, one like you is not usually refused. And if he asks for marriage, asks a woman for marriage, she cannot usually say no to him. ولكنك امرؤ كافر. But you are a kafir. وأنا امرأة مسلمة. And I am a Muslim woman. لا يصلح لي أن أتزوجك. It is not acceptable or permissible for me to marry you. فقال ما ذاك دهرك. ما ذاك دهرك؟ قالت وما دهري. He said, I do not know this about you, or that you were not like this, which means you were not a Muslim before. Why are you now saying this? قالت وما دهري. So what is then the thing that I am used to, or was you think that I used to like more than this? قال الصفراء والبيضاء. He said, the white and the yellow, which means gold and silver, which means you did not used to worry about Islam before as much as gold and silver, which means that what would I would have expected you to seek gold and silver without being concerned about whether I'm a Muslim or not Muslim. Your concern should be more about my wealth, and I am wealthy, as you know. قالت فإني لا أريد صفراء ولا بيضاء. She said, no, I do not want gold or silver. أريد منك الإسلام. I want you to embrace Islam. فإن تسلم فذلك مهري. فذاك مهري. If you embrace Islam, then that will be my مهر. I will accept to marry you. ولا أسألك غيرا. And I will not ask you for anything else. قال فمن لي بذلك. He said, who is the one who can help me with this? قالت لك بذلك رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. She said, رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم can help you with this. فانطلق أبو طلحة يريد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. So Abu Talha went to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. ورسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم جالس في أصحابه. While Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم was sitting among his companions. فلما رآه قال جاءكم أبو طلحة. When he saw him, he said, Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said to his companions, here Abu Talha is coming to you. غرة الإسلام بين عينيه. The sign of Islam is between his eyes. فأخبر رسول الله بما قالت أم سليم. So he told رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم what أم سليم told him. فتزوجها على ذلك, and he married her for that, or upon that, which means for that mahr that she asked for. Now here we have to understand that those Sahaba were very truthful, and unlike some people of our time, that a woman tells the man, I am a Muslim, if you want to marry me, you have to embrace Islam. He said, okay, I'll do whatever you want. And he will say, how do I embrace Islam? You say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Okay, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. But he doesn't know what is Islam. Maybe she also doesn't know exactly what Islam means. And he says it not for the sake, out of belief in Islam, but just to marry that woman. No, for those Sahaba, Islam was a commitment. And definitely Abu Talha had already heard about Islam and learned some of his principles from the other Ansar who were, because Islam was like the talk of the city after the Prophet ﷺ migrated to Medina and even before that. So he definitely has some understanding of what Islam is. And he understood that it means a great commitment. And when he was going to the Prophet ﷺ to embrace Islam and to marry Umm Sulaym, it is not just for the sake of marrying that woman, but that he found that as a prompting reason for him to go and accept something that he has already learned about and was pretty ready for it. So when Umm Sulaym asked him for her mahr to be Islam, he did not find any rejection for that, and he was ready to go and accept it in front of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he married Umm Sulaym. Thabit al-Bunani, who is one of the reporters from Anas, who is a tabi'i reporting from Anas radiallahu anhu, he said, فَمَا بَلَغَنَا أَنَّ مَهْرًا كَانَ أَعْظَمَ مِنْهُ أَنَّهَا رَضِيَتِ الْإِسْلَامَ مَهْرًا. We were not told of any person receiving a mahr greater than that mahr that Umm Sulaym received for her marriage. She accepted Islam as her mahr. فَتَزَوَّجَهَا, he married her. وَكَانَتْ امْرَأَةً مَلِيحَةَ الْعَيْنَيْنِ, and she was a woman of beautiful eyes. He's talking about his mother. فيها صغر, and she was small in size. فكانت معه حتى ولد له بني, she stayed with him until, that is Umm Sulaym, she stayed married to Abu Talha until they had a child. كان يحبه أبو طلحة حبا شديدا, and Abu Talha loved this child an extreme love. ومرض الصبي مرضا شديدا, and this child became extremely sick. Now this child, his name was Umair, and in some of the ahadith that the Prophet ﷺ passed by a little child playing, his name was Umair, the same Umair. And he said to him, oh Umair, ما فعل النغير, what happened to the little bird? He was crying like his bird, he had a little bird and it died. So he was comforting him. He said, oh Umair, what happened to the little bird? So this little child, Umair, died later on. Probably he was like 3-4 years of age, Allahu Alam. But he died. He became very sick and then he died, as we will learn very soon. So I said it before I read it. So he became extremely sick, Umair. And his father, Abu Talha, used to love him a lot. And sometimes he, Abu Talha, and sit in the majlis of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to learn Islam from him. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to have like a halqa of teaching Islam in the morning in the masjid. So Abu Talha was a wealthy man; he did not have to work. So he used to go from his house in Al-Awali, which means in the suburbs of Al-Madinah, walk all the way to the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, take with him something to eat and spend the morning with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and not come back home until after or close to Asr time. So sometimes take with him his son Umair, and Umair would sit in his lap or would jump on his back and so on, and he would kiss him and so on. So once Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked him, he said, O Abu Talha, do you love him? أتحبه يا أبا طلحة? Do you love him? Of course, I mean, it's obvious that he loves him. So Abu Talha said, يا رسول الله, أحبك الله كما أحبه. He said, oh Allah's Messenger, may Allah love you as much as I love this child. Which means I love him beyond your imagination. So anyways, ومرض الصبي مرضا شديدا وتواضع أبو طلحة لمرضه أو تضعضع له. So when the child became very sick, like Abu Talha became very tired, or what you say, he was broke down because of the sickness of his son. Huh? Despondent? Despondent. فكان أبو طلحة يقوم صلاة الغداة يتوضأ ويأتي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فيصلي معه. Abu Talha used to get up in the morning, perform wudu, and then go to the masjid of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and pray with him. ويكون معه إلى قريب نصف النهار and stay with him until close to the middle of the day. ويجيء يقيل ويأكل, and then he goes to his home and take a nap and eat. فإذا صلى الظهر تهيأ وذهب فلم يجئ إلى صلاة العتمة. And then after Dhuhr, after praying Dhuhr, which means that he used to pray Dhuhr in his area, in his house, or in the area where he was, he prepared himself and went back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. فَلَمْ يَجِئْ إِلَى صَلَاةِ الْعَتْمَةِ. And then he would not come back until the Maghrib prayer or the Isha prayer, whatever it is. Atma means the darkness, the prayer of the dark. فانطلق أبو طلحة عشية إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وفي رواية إلى المسجد. So one afternoon, عشية means afternoon, like near Asr time, close to the Maghrib time. So one afternoon he went, Abu Talha, to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, to the masjid, and in his absence the child died. فقالت أم سليم لا ينعين إلى أبي طلحة أحد ابنه حتى أكون أنا الذي أنعاه له. So أم سليم said, let not anyone mention to Abu Talha the death of his child until I be the first to tell him. So she, to whom she is saying this? Maybe to the servants in the house, to Anas, or anybody who was there, her sister, if there are sisters, children, girls, etc. فهيأت الصبي فسجت عليه ووضعته في جانب البيت. So she prepared the child, which means what? Yeah, she prepared him for burial. See that woman, her heart, her strong heart. She prepared the child for burial, which means she washed him and wrapped him and made him ready for burial. And she put him in a corner of the house. وجاء أبو طلحة من عند رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم حتى دخل عليها. رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم then came. Sorry, Abu Talha radiallahu anhu came from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he came into the house where she was. وَمَعَهُ نَاسٌ مِّنْ أَهْلِ الْمَسْجِدِ أَصْحَابًا. And he had with him some of his companions from the people of the masjid. فَقَالَ كَيْفَ ابْنِي. He asked her, how is my son doing? فَقَالَتْ يَا أَبَا طَلْحَ مَا كَانَ مُنْذُ اشْتَكَى أسكن منه الساعة وأرجو أن يكون قد استراح. She said, oh Abu Talha, he was, since he became sick, he was never as quiet as he is now. And I hope that he is now استراح, which means he is relaxed or in good situation, in good condition. فأتته بعشائه فقربته إليهم فتعشوا وخرج القوم. So she brought his food and she put it in front of them. They ate, everybody ate, the people, that the guests that he had with him, and then the men who were there left after that. فقام إلى فراشه فوضع رأسه. So he went to his bed, Abu Talha, to sleep, and he put his head, he laid his head down, which means he was ready to sleep. ثم قامت فتطيبت. Umm Sulaim got up and perfumed herself, wore perfume. وتصنعت له أحسن ما كانت تصنع قبل ذلك. And she beautified herself for him the best way that she used to beautify herself before that. ثم جاءت حتى دخلت معه الفراش Now I don't know how Anas knows about all these details unless his mother told him later on that this is what happened. ثم جاءت حتى دخلت معه الفراش. And then she came until she entered into the bed in under the covers with him. فما هو إلا أن وجد ريح الطيب كان منه ما يكون من الرجل إلى أهله. So when he smelled the perfume, then he did what a man would do with his wife. فلما كان آخر الليل قالت يا أبا طلحة أرأيت لو أن قوما أعاروا قوما عارية لهم فسألوهم إياها أكان لهم أن يمنعوهم. She said at the end of the night, she said, oh Abu Talha, if some people lend other people something that belongs to them and then later on they ask them to give it back, can they tell them, no, we don't want to give it to you? قال said, no. قالت فإن الله عز وجل كان أعارك ابنك عارية ثم قبضه إليه فاحتسب واصبر. She said, indeed then Allah عز وجل had previously landed you your son as a for a limited time and then he took him back. فاحتسب واصبر. So make احتساب, seek the reward from Allah Azza wa Jal for this affliction. واصبر, and be patient. فغضب, he became angry. ثم قال تركتني حتى إذا وقعت بما وقعت به نعيت إلي ابني. He said, you left me until I did what I did with you, which means, you know, we had all this pleasure and fun. And now after that you tell me about the death of my son. فاسترجع وحمد الله. Then he probably came back to his senses. He said, إِنَّ لِلَّهُ وَإِنَّ إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ عَلَى كُلِّ حَالٍ. فَلَمَّا أَصْبَحَ اغْتَسَلَ. And then in the morning he took a ghusl, a shower. ثُمَّ غَدَى إِلَى رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمَ. And then he went to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. فَأَخْبَرَهُ فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, and he told him what happened. So Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, بارك الله لكما في غابر ليلتكما. May Allah bless for you that which took place in your previous night. فثقلت من ذلك الحمل. And Im Sulaim became heavy because of that pregnancy, which means she became pregnant and she got her pregnancy full term. وكانت أم سليم تسافر مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم تخرج إذا خرج وتدخل معه إذا دخل. Inshallah, this story of Umm Sulaim, I have it mostly on computer. Maybe inshallah it will be produced as a booklet with some commentary in the near future. So Umm Sulaim used to travel with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, go out with him when he goes out in the travel, and come back with him when he came back. So when he had a trip or a fight or something, she was among the women who went with the men to help in that expedition or travel. And she was among the few women like Umm Sulaim, Aisha and others who would help. And sometimes when there is fighting, when there are injured people. وقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا ولدت فأتوني بالصبي. So Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, she was pregnant and she still was going with him. So he said, when she delivers, bring the child to me. قال فكان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في سفر وهي معه, وكان إذا أتى المدينة من سفر لا يطرقها طروقا فدلوا من المدينة فضربها المخاض. So she was with him in one of those travels, and the Prophet's صلى الله عليه وسلم habit was that when he came back to Al-Madinah, he would not enter it in a sudden way, but he will camp outside and then send some people to say that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم is just on the outskirts camping and he'll be here tomorrow or something like that. So he would not come suddenly to scare so that the men would scare their wives, because he said, do not go suddenly if you are traveling to your wife. Just give her time to prepare herself for you and so on. And so he camped outside the Medina. And at that time, ضربها المخاض. Labor started with Umm Sulaym. واحتبس عليها أبو طلحة. And Abu Talha remained with her to serve her, to help her. فقال أبو طلحة, and Abu Talha said, يا ربي إنك لتعلم أنه يعجبني أن أخرج مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أخرج وأدخل معه إذا دخل قد احتبست بما ترى. So Abu Talha made dua. He said, oh Allah, you know that I love that. Now here there is some taqdeem and ta'khir, like there are some things mentioned in the story and then they go say something that happened before them and then they go back and say some things that happened after. And I have arranged, rearranged them in the English translation that as I was referring to in the proper sequence. But what it means here is that, Allahu A'lam, in the beginning of the trip, about to depart, started feeding the labor. Her husband was nursing her, serving her, helping her. And he made the dua, oh Allah, you will know that I love to go with the Prophet ﷺ whenever he goes and come back whenever he comes. I like to be in his company in his travels. And you know, Abu Talha was one of the powerful companions. He was wealthy, but his wealth did not make him lazy. Rather, he was one of the very powerful companions, and as Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "La sawtu Abi Talha fi al-jaysh khayrun min alf faris aw mi'at faris," kama qala alayhi sallatu wasallam. He said the sound of Abu Talha in the army is better than 100, or he said 1000, I don't remember the exact figure, knights, 1000 strong powerful fighters, his voice alone. And he was of the few fighters, of the few companions who stayed by the Prophet ﷺ when everybody was scared and ran away during the Battle of Uhud. You know, the Battle of Uhud, when the archers were supposed to stand in their place and protect the back of the army, but then when they thought that they were victorious, they came down, and then the enemy came from around them and defeated the Muslims. And at that time, the Muslims became in a state of chaos, and they started running everywhere. And only very few remained with the Prophet ﷺ. So Abu Talha was one of these few. He was standing in front of the Prophet ﷺ, protecting him with his body, so that no harm would happen to him, would reach him. So this Sahabi was a true lover, as like the Sahaba were, of the Prophet ﷺ. And this was one of the basic important characteristics, the Sahaba, that they loved the Prophet ﷺ more than we can imagine. So he loved to go with him whenever he went and come back with him whenever he came back. And he made dua to Allah, oh Allah, you know that this is what I like to do. And I have been stopped because of what you see, which means the pregnancy of his wife and that she is about to deliver. So Umm Sulaym said, oh Abu Talha, ma ajidu alladhi kuntu ajid. So Umm Sulaym told him, no, I'm not feeling labor anymore. Let's go. So they went. فانطلقا. They went with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. قال وضربها المخاض حتى قدموا. And then the labor started with her on their way back. And this is when they were camping outside the Medina, and she delivered at that time. And the Prophet ﷺ said, after she delivers, bring me the baby. فولدت غلاما. So she gave birth to a boy. وقالت لابنها أنس, يا أنس لا يطعم شيئا حتى تغدو به إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. وبعثت معه بتمرات. She said, oh Anas, let him not eat anything, this baby, until you first take him to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And she sent him to him, she asked him to take the baby to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and she gave him a few dates with him. قال فبات يبكي وبت مجنحا عليه أكالئه تا أصبحت. So the child started crying. Anas is saying the child, the baby, his brother, started crying, and I was leaning over him, watching him, trying to quiet him down. But he cannot feed him or do anything to him. His mother told him, don't feed him anything until the morning you take him to the Prophet ﷺ. So all night long he was serving or taking care of the baby, hatta asbaht, until the morning. فَغَدَوْتُ إِلَىٰ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمْ. So I took him to Rasulullah ﷺ in the morning. وَعَلَيْهِ بُرْدَةً, a burda, like an over gown. وَهُوَ يَسِمُ إِبِلًا أَوْ غَنَمًا. And he was marking some camels or some sheep. He was not sure whether they were sheep or camel, or the reporter was not sure. But he was marking some animals, like he is marking that these are, you know how the, sometimes the, but he's not branding them with iron. This is prohibited in Islam, but he was marking them somehow. فَلَمَّا نَظَرَ إِلَيْهِ قَالْ لِأَنَسِ أولدت بنت ملحان. When he saw the child, the baby, he said, did the daughter of ملحان give birth? So her father was ملحان, his name was ملحان, Sulaim's father. So he said, did ملحان give birth? And Anas said, yes. قال رويدك أفرغ لك. So Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, wait a minute until I'm ready for you, let me finish what I'm doing. فألقى ما في يده. So he dropped what he had in his hand, whatever thing he was using to mark the animals. فتناول الصبي. And he held the child. وقال أمعه شيء. He said, did you bring anything with you? قال نعم. قالوا نعم تمرات. Yes, some dates. فأخذ النبي بعض التمر. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم took some of that date. فمضغهن. He chewed on them. ثم جمع بزاقه. And then he collected his saliva. ثم فغرفاه وأوجره إياه. Then he opened the mouth of the child and put that into his mouth. فجعل يحنك الصبي. And he started moving that around the hanak, which means the jaws of the child from the inside. وجعل الصبي يتلمذ. And the child started licking that sweet saliva mixed with the sweetness of the dates. يمص بعض حلاوة التمر وريق رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, sucking on the sweetness of the dates and the saliva of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. فكان أول من فتح ذلك الصبي على ريق رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. So the first thing that opened the intestines of that child was the saliva of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. فقال انظروا إلى حب الأنصار التمر. And Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, look how the Ansar like dates, because that child was enjoying the taste. قال قلت يا رسول الله سمي. So Anas said, and this is part of his mother's request, that she told him, take him and let Rasulullah give. So he said, oh Allah, must give him. قال فمسح وجهه. So he rubbed over his face. وسماه عبد الله. And he named him Abdullah. فما كان في الأنصار شاب أفضل منه. And there was no young man among the Ansar better than Abdullah. Anas is saying about his son, his brother. قال فخرج منه رجل كثير. And a large number of men came out from that child, which means he had lots of children. واستشهد عبد الله بفارس. And Abdullah died as a shaheed as a martyr in Fars, in Persia.